Hello, Internet. This is Oscar Lise again, continuing our series on minimization, this time looking at Fibonacci search. We'll go over the history and visualization, as well as the algorithm and an example. As a primer, you should already be familiar with ternary search and dichotomous search. Recall that with both of these methods, the values for C and D are never reused. Let's refer back to Optimum Seeking Methods by Wild. In it, the author writes, "Powerful as the dichotomous technique is, there exists a method that is even better. The epsilon minimax sequential search scheme was found by Kiefer in 1953. In sequential minimax search for a maximum, Kiefer uses the Fibonacci sequence to find a maximum, starting with 0 and 1, adding those two terms to come up with the next term in the series to give 1, then using 1 and 1 to get 2, and so on, giving the famous Fibonacci sequence. Here's the rest of that paragraph, but don't panic, let's look at another paper. 3 years later, Johnson published Best Exploration for a Maximum is Fibonaccian, in which he writes, "When the author obtained the results presented here, he thought it was new. Subsequently, it was found that the result had previously been published by Kiefer. In his version of the Fibonacci sequence, he starts from 1 and 1. Going back to Kiefer's paper, there are two important ratios that we'll be using. Using these two ratios, as an example, let's let n be the value of 6, and our Fibonacci sequence would look like this. I'm ignoring the 0 just to keep things simple. Our first ratio would be 5 over 13, and our second would be 8 over 13. But how does this look visually? Imagine a line segment of length 13. That's a Fibonacci number. Using the previous two Fibonacci numbers, we can divide it into 5 and 8 at some point C. Then using the ratio with 8, we can compute this new value, d. Notice how it is symmetric. Using the 8 on the right side, we can divide it up again into its previous Fibonacci numbers of 3 and 5. Using the same approach of 5 now, we can compute a new value for d. Taking the 5 on the right side, we can divide that up again into its two previous Fibonacci numbers, 2 and 3. The same with 3 on the right side into 1 and 2, 2 on the right side into 1 and 1. Because this process is symmetric, it doesn't really matter if you choose the left or right side. Eventually, you can break this down into 1 and 1. We'll now use this process to find a minimum. Here, we'll use the last three digits in our Fibonacci sequence of 3, 5, and 8 to come up with 3 over 8 and 5 over 8. We'll use these equations to come up with our new values C and D. Then, using what we know from ternary search, when f of C is less than f of D, we eliminate the rightmost interval. And this time, we'll replace C with D and D with B. We also have lowered our Fibonacci terms to be 2, 3, and 5. Using our numbers for C, we will pick 2 over 5 to compute our next value. Here, f of c is still less than f of d, eliminate the right side. We lowered our Fibonacci terms again. In this case, we'll need a new value for c, which is 1 over 3. In this example, we want to eliminate the leftmost interval. Now we've reached 1 and 1. So we'll stop. Wild again. Now we can see what it is about the Fibonacci search plan that makes it better than the dichotomous technique. In a Fibonacci scheme, each new experiment serves to reduce the interval of uncertainty. But in a dichotomous scheme, it takes two new experiments to cut down the interval of uncertainty. Going back to our line segments, we stopped once we reached any two 1x1s, going from 13 down to 2. Each unit interval is essentially b minus a over 13, or b minus a over f of 6. More generally, we can write this as f of n down to some 2x2 interval. We can rewrite it as b minus a over f of n equal to some epsilon. Also, b minus a over epsilon equal to some f of n. The trouble then becomes, how do you find f of n? From our equation, and as an example, we'll use b minus a equal to 1 and epsilon of 0.01. Plugging that in, we get 100. This means we need to find the Fibonacci term of 100 or larger. Scrolling down, the first value we find is 144, giving n of 11. Johnson again, he notes that f of 20 is greater than 10,000, giving an epsilon accuracy of 10 to the minus 4, requiring 20 function calls, whereas dichotomous search would take 28. In reality, we shouldn't represent them now as one by ones, but rather epsilons. This does mean that our final ending condition has a length of 2 epsilon. If that really bothers you, you can always switch to another search technique afterwards, or start with f of n plus 1. The algorithm for Fibonacci search looks something like this. Starting with some unimodal function f of x and the interval a, b, start with the Fibonacci sequence at 1, 1, and set n equal to 1. Then add 1 to n and compute the next term in the Fibonacci sequence. If this does not give you a small enough epsilon, go and compute the next term. In the case that it does, start computing c and d, and then save the function calls at f of c and f of d. Then, check if n is equal to 2. When it is, that's our minimum. You can turn a plus b over 2. In this case, you could optionally return c or d, because those would also be the midpoints. And then stop. When it isn't, remove 1 from n, and then check if f of c is less than f of d. When it is, that means we'll eliminate our interval on the right, and then save off our values for c and f of c, then compute a new value for c and a new f of c. Otherwise, we'd eliminate the term on the left and do the opposite side. Then repeat the process. Using again the same example from the other videos, it took Fibonacci search 28 iterations to find our ending interval. Ternary required 34 iterations, but dichotomous was even faster at 19. How is that better than Fibonacci's 28? Well, the real power comes from the number of function calls that the method requires. As a fun fact, this method actually found our minimum in the first iteration, but it doesn't know that until it shrinks the interval small enough. In that example, our b minus a was equal to 1, and our ending epsilon was 10 to the minus 6, which would mean we need a Fibonacci value of at least a million, which happened after f of 30, meaning n was 30. Our value for d was this number, and our minimum was that number. Very close. Going back to Kiefer one last time, he lets mu be the value of 0.618, and then our ratios be mu and 1 minus mu to give the same geometric configuration. What does he mean by that? Johnson also refers to this 0.618 number, noting this constant ratio to determine the next x would be useful in a computing machine code, referring to the golden section. Foreshadowing? Before you go, Fibonacci search is guaranteed to find a minimum, and it's going to do so with a linear order, but it will save on function calls compared to ternary search and dichotomous search. There is some overhead though with computing the Fibonacci sequence and finding what term you'll want to use for n, but this leads right into the golden section search, the topic for another video. The code that I used for this example will be hosted on GitHub. As always, thank you for watching. I hope I was able to visualize how Fibonacci search worked in a way that made sense. If you want to see the video on golden section search, make sure to subscribe to the channel and turn on notifications so you can see when it comes out. Again, thank you for watching.